normal complaint to our buildings department in Yonkers. The buildings department wrote up a repair that needed to be addressed. The landlord ignored it. I then moved on to the state of New York and filed a complaint with HCR, whatever that's called now. They came out after making me wait for approximately 6 months to get a docket number, then another 3 months to get someone to come out and visually look at the repair. A report was written, I was given an order that the repairs had to be made, and that was sent to the landlord and to me in September 2013. Nothing occurred. I called the State Department to indicate the repairs were not being made as ordered by the State of New York. Nothing was ever done. On December 26th, the day after Christmas, 2014, I decided I've had enough. The repairs that were needed were taken on by me, paid by me, and totaled to date and completed by me. When I say by me, I paid a contractor, I purchased the materials, I am now out of pocket $11,127 for repairs that initially in 2012 would have been ordinary repairs. Now, my comments end here. I am very concerned about the destiny or where this will go, but I would point out that I raised an autistic grandson who currently lives with me, who is 27 years of age, who is gainfully employed. And I know that if I die, and likely being sooner than later, he will not have the capacity to deal with all of this nonsense. So my thing is, my landlord is not making repairs. It seems to be a trend, and this is how it goes for most people in my situation. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms.
Done. I proceeded. I have a contract. I have bills. I have paid receipts. I have deductions from my account. And as I said, my landlord turned up 3 weeks ago to find out what was going on. His only recourse now is to take me to housing court, where I will gladly meet him, because at this point, I feel he's not entitled to anything, and I will be seeking a rebate.
Ma'am,
I'm sorry.
Changed my mind. I'm sorry. $11,000 is a considerable amount of money. In general, what did you do?
I had my apartment painted. Uh-huh. It was 8 years overdue.
What else?
Okay. The kitchen cabinets were totally rotten. I purchased kitchen cabinets. The floors were totally imbalanced. I had those replaced. Moving into the bathroom, the sink had to be replaced. There were plumbing repairs. The floor was rotted. It had to be replaced. And as a result, all of the tile in the bathroom had to be replaced. So when you add the purchase of the materials and the labor costs, I am out almost
$12,000. Sherry, what happened? What did you do? Good evening, everybody. I am Jerry Flynn, Flynn and Farm Brokers. And I'm the Apartment Owners Advisory Council's co-vice chairman. And my company owns approximately 130 apartments in Westchester County, subject to legislation passed and approved by this Rent Guideline Board. We appreciate your time and efforts once again this year. I'm here to speak about the real estate taxes. The real estate taxes are the largest expense item out of the 10 expense items shown on your DHCR operation and maintenance surveys. They comprise between 15% to 20% of the total operating expenses of an ETPA apartment building. This year, there are approximately 18% of the total cost. This expense has increased almost 4% over the last year, and is the only expense that never decreases unless there's a tax grievance filed by the owner. And in that case, it doesn't appear in your survey as an expense item, it appears as income. The material I just handed out shows a graph of the real property tax rates and their annual increases in the cities with the highest concentration of ETPA apartments as compared to the rent increases passed by this board since 2002. Those cities include White Plains, Mount Vernon, New Rochelle, and Yonkers. There's a very visible lag on the graph of the tax increases as compared to the rent increases, and it continues to widen. From 2002 to 2015, taxes increased 3 times the rate of rent increases, 3 times. And if this trend continues, and it probably will, the graph will continue to widen even further. If you look at the overall operating expenses on the tables this year, if you do the math, you'll see that the average cost to operate an apartment in the county is approximately $1,050 per month. The real estate tax expense per apartment then is an average of $188 per month of that $1,050. Consequently, then an owner would have to collect a minimum of $1,050 in rent to operate his or her building just to break even before any capital improvements. The average ETPA building is nearly 100 years old. Capital improvements are a necessity. To expand on this further, if the average cost to operate an apartment is $1,050 per month, how can one justify collecting that amount? It would have to be more. Who would invest in a property where there's no profit, no upside? If someone has been in an apartment for 20 years and pays $600, $700, or $800 a month, is it justifiable for a landlord to come out of pocket every month, every year, up to $100,000 possibly over 20 years to keep the tenant in possession? No, but we do. Owners do. And with all due respect to the last speaker, for the most part, owners are generally grateful for their tenancy, and in reciprocity, the tenants are grateful for their owners. The owners provide a valuable need to the county in the form of affordable housing, and most of us take pride in that. Please remember that. Thank you.
Any questions from the questions or comments from the board members?
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gilman. Al Kessner.
Hello, my name is Adam Kessner. I represent K5 Equities. We own and operate a few hundred units in Westchester County. I want to keep this very simple. You know, as landlords, we're not looking to make a killing. You know, we're just looking to operate nice, efficient properties, provide proper services to our tenants. You know, we follow the rules, we try to take care of our tenants' apartments when needed. But the recurring theme here amongst the landlords is that costs are rising. And it's getting more and more expensive to operate property in Westchester County. And in order to make a profit, which we are in a business to make a profit, otherwise the buildings would, you know, go into foreclosure and the tenants wouldn't have proper services to begin with. We have to have enough increase in revenue to support the expenses. My family started in the city a long time ago, and we bought buildings that were dilapidated. Tenants were living there with no heat, no water, because the landlords couldn't afford to run the buildings. And I just want to say, without proper increase in revenue, we can't effectively operate our buildings. And that's about it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Making a profit in our buildings, but decline in, with expenses, you know, it's going to go, it's going to go the opposite direction. I mean, real estate ownership is an investment. You know, we're not just the owner. We have hundreds of investors that rely on these investments as if you were investing in the stock market. So yes, this is, you know, we're in this, it's a business. We have to earn a profit.
Thank you very much.
Ms. Rubin?
Yes. Mr. President, what is the margin of profit that you make right now?
I can't answer that question. I mean, there's, each building is different. It depends on when you bought the building, you know. I'll tell you right now, we just bought a few buildings and, you know, the profit margin is very, very slim. If 5% of the tenants didn't pay their rents, we wouldn't be able to cover the expenses.
That's right.
That's scary.
I think you said that you own and operate a few hundred units in Westchester County. How many of those are, you know, approximately are rent-regulated?
I believe it's around 20%.
20%. So I assume you're making, or is it safe to assume you're making a profit on your other buildings?
Our buildings are making a profit, otherwise we would lose the buildings. But yeah.
I'm still sticking to the margin of profit. What would be the ideal margin of profit that you would love to make?
In today's world, very, very little. everything is very expensive these days. As you see in the single family market, it's the same in the multifamily market. Everything's very, very expensive. I can't answer specific profit margins. What I can say is it's very slim. Real estate is a very long-term business. You don't buy a property now to, you know, make have a home run now. It's a long-term game. Our projections are 10, 15, 20 years down the road. So right now we'll acquire an asset to hopefully do well and provide, you know, good service to our tenancy. But nothing's guaranteed. And this is part of the equation. If we can't increase our rents to sustain the expenses, that's not good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For temperature or sound, so occupants can literally hear everything coming and going on either side, over their head, and underneath. I live next door to a family with two small children who run up and down the stairs, back and forth, across the floor, screaming at the top of their lungs well past 9 p.m. And after that, the parents decide it's an appropriate time to do carpentry projects. During the summer months, it is oppressively hot, and in the winter time, visibly cold. During the winter, Consolidated Edison recommends maintaining an internal temperature of 68 degrees. However, the interior of many units are situated over concrete parking spaces, and the sustained cold air comes up through the wooden apartment floors, requiring thermostats be turned above the recommended level. During this past winter, tenants received monthly bills from Consolidated Edison ranging from $600 to $1,200. To conserve energy and control costs, Consolidated Edison recommends maintaining an internal temperature of 78 degrees during the summer months. This is virtually impossible as these units are extremely difficult to keep comfortable. The management solution to keep the property clear of leaves was to cut down most of the trees, which meant that what little natural cooling we once had has been diminished. Given the age of this building, structural maintenance is mandatory, yet with every change in management since the original owner sold the property comes more deterioration and blight. The concrete and wooden steps are crumbling and loose. Concrete landings near my apartment are not level. Former swimming pool area has been converted to a yard for tractors, dump trucks, and other equipment. The wooden porches become damaged as furniture and appliances are taken in and out of the units. The wooden terraces have been damaged when moving trucks enter and exit parking lot. Efficient snow removal rarely begins in time for most tenants to plan a safe and timely commute to work. Sometimes snow removal does not begin until sometime after the snow has stopped falling. Typically, there is no preparation in advance of snowfall, so tenants are left to their own devices and must keep their cars out of their parking spaces. Surface areas are usually iced over, so tenants must navigate safe passage to their vehicles and to the street. I've watched cars sliding and heard tires spinning as tenants struggle to enter and exit the parking lot. There is no superintendent on the premises, so tenants must call management office to address maintenance issues. I have waited months for repairs because the management does not provide service after working hours nor during weekends. I've also taken off time from work only to have no one show up to address repairs. Year after year, landlords demand more with their chronic lamentations about what a terrible burden residential property management is.
Thank you. It's 3 minutes, so it's tied up. You can finish the sentence.
I'm done.
I hope so.
Seacole, the manager of the commercial division for Robeson Oil. I've been invited here to give testimony regarding the cost of the heating properties. I've been with Robeson for 25 years. Historically, June, but right now, is when oil prices are low and typically go up in the winter. We are anticipating that oil prices will increase by about 25% by the end of this year. Electricity prices continue to rise. Gas prices are off their historic highs, but they're also anticipated to rise this winter. Another factor in annual energy costs for heating the property is the trend of the colder winters that we've seen in recent years. Last winter was 15% colder than the average of the last 10 years. Should mention that average includes last winter, so the increase is probably even more than that. The expense to maintain heating equipment should be considered as well. The cost to repair or replace heating systems continues to rise every year. I brought a few charts just to illustrate some of these trends and costs that I've mentioned. Any questions? Thank you.
sorry, Ms. Roach had a question, so can you just come back up, please, Mr. Seacole?
One second.
I see that you have a question.
Yeah, Mr. Seacole, thank you. These projections that you stated with respect to energy costs on what they base?
Based on what I read in the paper, what I read online, what I listen to on CNBC. Basically, my spare time is I have CNBC running, or Bloomberg, just you know, all different sources, just and the trends, just what we've seen over what I've seen over the last 25 years.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else before Mr. Seacole sits down? Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Jason Schicciano.
Wow, did you pronounce that? Jason's not the tough name.
Good evening. My name is Jason Schicciano. I'm president of Love First Associates in Yonkers, New York. We're insurance brokers for the last 46 years, and we are one of Westchester's largest for the placement of habitational real estate insurance, including hundreds of condominiums, cooperatives, and apartment buildings. We represent many of the largest insurers in the real estate industry, including Chubb Travelers, Greater New York, Philadelphia, Fireman's Fund, Tower Ram Trust, Middle Oak, and Dungu. I've been asked once again by the Building Real Estate Institute, Building Realty Institute, as well as the Apartment Owners Advisory Council, to comment on the state of the insurance market as related to the apartment buildings in Westchester County. I will not speak to you tonight in generalities and hyperbole. Rather, I will give you factual data about why landlords and increases on insurance-related costs alone justify a tangible rent increase. Let me start with one number. 21%. Does anyone know what 21% represents? 21% is the cumulative percentage that DHCR reports insurance premiums have increased over the past 3 years, 2011 to 2014. 6.4% in 2012, 5.0% in 2013, and a whopping 9.5% in 2014. So during the past 3 years, insurance expenses for landlords have gone up 21%. Does anyone know what the cumulative rent increase for Westchester's rent control department is during the
past? I hope these are rhetorical questions that you yourself are going to answer.
They are, in fact. 5.75%. In other words, insurance expenses have increased nearly quadruple the allowed rent increase. Suppliers of goods and services to landlords, such as the insurance industry, are subject to the free market economy. In the free market economy, responding to low interest rates and high incidences of weather-related losses has delivered a 21% increase over the past 3 years. Landlords are not allowed to increase their rents in a free market style, and that's the system that they bought into. But when key expenses like insurance, but also fuel and utilities, are increasing by 15 to 20% over a 3 year period, and landlords are only allowed to increase rents by 5.75%, something just doesn't add up. Once again, for the fourth year in a row, our office has not had one single landlord in Westchester who's experienced a premium reduction on renewal. All landlords' renewal premiums, 100% of them, have gone up. So next year's DHCR recap will show more of the same, year after year of higher insurance expense. In addition, deductibles are up, accepted by reluctant landlords in order to try and offset in rising insurance premiums, and key coverages, such as water-related claim coverages, are being reduced or eliminated, which, along with additional deductibles, is making it more of a self-insured claim situation. I referenced the DHCR reports here, and it's an interesting fact. The only thing that saved landlords from massive double-digit bottom-line expense increases over the last several years has been reduced interest expenses. But payment of interest expenses means landlords have outstanding loans. Collectively, hundreds of millions, if not billions, in loans. These loans represent risk. Risk that renters do not have. Risk that renters may never be able to understand. This is not a comment on the more privileged versus the less privileged, because there are plenty of wealthy people that do not own real estate because they don't want to subject their assets to real estate risk. Westchester County landlords who own apartment buildings are subjecting their personal assets to significant financial risk, and at the same time, they are providing affordable housing. They are entitled to a reasonable rate of return on their investment, and in fact, the fact that interest rates have happened to have gone down in recent years, offsetting increases in all other expenses, should not be justification for denying a reasonable rent increase from this board. Numbers like a 3-year cumulative 21% insurance expense increase versus a 5.75% rent increase deserve this board's attention and reconciliation. Thank you.
Priorities that address on a daily basis. However, the most important is the task of maintaining a balanced budget. I pride myself on the ability to ensure that I can guarantee my owners a balanced budget while maintaining the integrity of the building and giving my tenants a better place to live. Unfortunately, no matter how successful or efficient my tactics may be, increased prices and daily costs of business often pose a burden to most owners. As a property manager, I serve as a middleman between the owner's dilemmas and the tenant's requests. Unfortunately, when expenses continue to soar and income does not increase, it is very hard to maintain property. Improvements that will be needed to buildings that are 40 to 60 years old will most likely and definitely have to be postponed. With large maintenance projects that are postponed, there's always a chance that bigger problems may occur. This is an example of a common situation that landlords are facing every day. A major misconception of the landlord is that he or she is worry-free. On the contrary, many landlords are sometimes forced to sell their buildings just to avoid foreclosure. The scenario is frightening, and because more and more hardworking individuals who have worked their entire life to have a piece of the American dream are failing. It's too easy to turn around and accuse the owner of not knowing how to manage his or her business when he or she is struggling to maintain the building. This is unfortunately the reality that we see way too often. This is why I stand here before you this evening and ask you to seriously consider voting for a fair increase in the DHCR rental guidelines. Fair increases aid the owner and the property management team as they deal with the ever-growing utility expenses and annual taxes and insurance. Unfortunately, small percentage increases will never balance out the expenses that the landlord takes on. This is why I ask you to please consider fair guidelines. Thank you very much.
Might not be fair to someone else.
But it's 8% increase. That's fair. Okay.
Now, you said that you manage 427 units at what locations?
In Westchester.
I know it's Westchester.
Mount Vernon, Yonkers.
Mount Vernon, and Yonkers? Thank you.
What percentage of those units are rent regulated?
It's 10-15%.
10-15%? Anybody else? Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Good evening, board members, advocates, and my fellow citizens. My name is Tamara Stewart. I live at 30 Park Avenue in Mount Vernon, and I am the treasurer of the Monticello Tenants Council. With almost 700 apartments in four buildings, Westchester Plaza is the largest rental apartment complex in the city of Mount Vernon. And as I've previously stated, the complex is being neglected by Urban American Management. Over the past several weeks, I've had conversations with tenants, advocates, landlords, friends, family, and real estate brokers about ETPA in general and rent increases in particular. Based on many of these conversations combined with independent research, I've come to the conclusion that there are no easy solutions to New York's affordable housing problems. Ideally, I believe that a two-tiered system would work better, with large buildings in one tier and small properties in the other. Unfortunately, such a system doesn't currently exist, and you are tasked with acting in the best interest of the majority of those involved. I wanted to take this opportunity to speak to an observation that is often made regarding tenants' attendance at these hearings, or rather, the lack thereof. In the past week alone, I have personally invited no less than 30 of my neighbors and associates to attend the WRGB series of hearings. No one I invited to Yonkers was able to attend. However, approximately 10 people showed up to the hearing in Mount Vernon, and several people testified. Out of the remaining invitees, 9 people had to work, 8 people had to care for children or elders, 3 people had health issues, and several others offered various reasons for their inability to attend. While many of my invitees were as cynical about whether their voice or presence would make a difference, all were concerned about the outcome of these hearings. On the bright side, I see several people I invited in the audience tonight, and I expect that at least a couple of them will testify. What I'd like for you to take into consideration about the matter of tenants' attendance at your hearings is that tenants, writ large, do care a great deal about possible rent increases. Many tenants, however, work 2 or more jobs, have significant family obligations, health challenges, other commitments, and no small measure of understandable cynicism and resignation about their ability to influence the outcome of these hearings. So please appreciate how much determination it takes for however few tenants to attend your hearings. Several people I spoke with are nervous about speaking publicly. It takes courage to speak one's truth while risking retaliation from less than upstanding landlords, all without knowing whether one's words will even influence the outcome. Once again, I ask you to pass 0% rent increases to struggling tenants who are just trying to survive. Once again, I thank you for your thoughtful consideration and deliberations about this important housing issue that affects tens of thousands of tenants. We're counting on you to do the right thing. Thank you.
Two questions. If there was such a two-tiered system, would small landlords get more than large landlords? Would that be your concept?
I think based on a lot of the conversation that I've had, because smaller landlords don't have as much turnover in their apartments, they're not getting the kind of vacancy bonuses that the large landlords are getting. They often are not institutionally doing the individual apartment improvements every time somebody moves out, whether they're needed or not. It sounds as if they have a legitimate reason for requesting the increases that they're requesting. Larger landlords seem to have a great deal more flexibility with regard to other ways to make a decent profit without.
You live in a large complex, don't you?
I certainly do.
How many units are there?
700 almost.
That's large. How would you define a small landlord?
Some of the landlords that I've spoken to, and I have friends who are landlords, right?
How many units?
I would say people who have buildings with under 25, oftentimes. Sorry. Under 25.
Under 25 units?
Mm-hmm.
What would you recommend for us to make it easier for people to attend our meetings?
I'm really not sure, because it's such a combination of factors. I mean, one, if people have a work conflict, they can't make it. I know one of the people who was scheduled to speak that you just called, Sam Swinson, he's at work. Hopefully he'll be here before things are over, but he really wanted to come and speak to you all. People who have children and they don't have anyone to watch their children, or they need to help their children with homework, or they've got elders, it's tough. People have a lot of commitments, and admittedly, some people may not have any of those concerns and still just be rather cynical and or afraid of retaliation and therefore unwilling to come out and speak up.
One more question.
Yes, go ahead.
The small landlords that you're talking about, it sounds to me like you don't think they should have a zero increase. What, in your mind, would be fair for these small landlords? What would the increase be?
I really don't know. In that sense, I have not digested the kind of numbers that you all have looked at with regard to the statistics. So I really would not want to hazard, just because I'd be just throwing something out.
Mm-hmm.
I just recognize through the conversations and through listening that it sounds as if small landlords are experiencing, they're having a difference set of challenges in large landlords, and then unfortunately, I think the majority of tenants are living in properties that are larger properties, but then again, I'd have to look at the numbers.
Right, it would be zero, right?
For small landlords, I would think that it would be something more than that for the small landlords.
Did you have a question?
Yes, ma'am.
And the number of years that you've lived at your residence, how's the turnover?
In my building in particular, it's been incredibly high. Mm-hmm. There is at least one apartment on my floor. I moved in 2006.
Mm-hmm.
That is on its fifth tenant?
Since 2006?
Yes. Our landlord makes a habit of using preferential leases to get people in, and then without fail, unless it's a very small difference between the preferential rent and then the market rate, raising it up to market rate, and then people can't afford to pay it, so they turn around and they leave. The landlord comes in, makes individual apartment improvements, even though he just made it last year or the year before that, and so on and so on and so on.
And this goes on throughout the complex.
Absolutely. Seems to be particularly high in my building, though.
Thank you. I just want to comment, you know, I think in all the years that I've been on board, and maybe some board members will correct me, I don't recall having heard anybody comment on how many people show up for the hearings and so forth. And I found that interesting, but I, you know, it also causes me to want to assure you and everybody else, really, that I know all the board members pretty well by now, with the exception of Lynn Aqua, and I trust her. We listen, and this is something that, as a representative of your complex, I would hope you would tell your fellow tenants that I think all of us really take this very seriously. We listen very carefully. We try as hard as we can, even though we obviously don't always agree, to strike a reasonable balance and in the end come out with a guideline that we believe is fair. So I think it's important to point that out, given the fact that you expressed, you know, concerns about some cynicism of some of your fellow tenants and so forth. So thank you for that.
I will take that back to them from you as a board to them. So thank you.
I don't hear anybody disagree.
Ms. Alice, thank her for moving that out as well. And I feel this is strongly as what you just said, that it is open to their complaints, and they should feel as though they can't come first.
Thank you.
Hi. You mentioned one of the reasons tenants don't come out was because they fear retaliation. Retaliation from this board?
From the landlord. Our landlord is very aggressive about taking people to court for all kinds of reasons, and whether or not it's as logical as you might think, there are people who are concerned that if they came out and if they spoke, or if they're behind in their rent, that the landlord might use that as a reason to go ahead and go after them and not say that that's what they're doing. So there's a fair amount of fear, particularly among seniors who have been in their apartments for a long time.
I just want to clarify that you were talking specifically about your building, and not all the landlords or owners can be painted with the same brush.
No, I know that there are at least in my complex, I know that that is something that I've heard from my neighbors, and there is the building across the street from mine, which is the one that my mom happens to live in, that I used to live in, and I've spoken to quite a few people in that building that expressed similar concerns.
Thank you, Ms.
Thank you all.
Ken Nelson?
He's here.
Oh.
My name is Ken Nelson. I'm a member of the AOAC board, former chairman of the AOAC. I've been doing this for a long time.
Why don't you tell everybody what the AOAC is?
The Apartment Owners Advisory Council with the landlords, landlord representatives. And I've been asked to talk about management expenses, which is kind of an amorphous item, and people don't, I think, fully understand the implications. I got the tables today, and just to let you know, management expenses went up by 4.3% over 1 year. Pretty much everything went up except interest rates went down. So just to start with, the cost of management expenses continues to increase year after year, largely because of the demands of government agencies and most especially the overreach of the DHCR. This has occurred in the last just a few years. Now, summarizing the description of what is included in management expense in the instructions for the property maintenance and operations cost survey includes management fees, office salaries, expenses, legal, accounting, auditing fees. Of course, this includes depositing rents, paying bills, dealing with engineers, lawyers, banks, insurance companies, contractors, suppliers, long-term and short-term, planning, personnel matters, and tenant relations. And these are all the things that are required to run a small business. It's no surprise. However, beyond these normal business functions are the government regulatory requirements for one of the most regulated businesses in the economy. For example, leases. When I first started this business 30 years ago, I would go around with a pad of leases and sit in the super's apartment and write out the lease. It was like one sheet, this is it. Since then, things have changed. So we have to go through applications forms, we do credit checks, we have a lease, we have writers because we had to include things that essentially the judges wanted to have in it. And then we have to include the what's called a preferential rent rider to explain the difference between legal regulated rents and preferential rents. Then the federal government came out with a requirement on lead paint warning statement, and so we have a one sheet, and then all the documentation that goes along with it. There are lead tests. There are wipe tests, and then to confirm in case there's any problem that there's a smoke detector in the apartment, there's another form, another one for a carbon monoxide detector. And then recently, and it goes on and on, recently the DHCR came up with a requirement that we have to attach to each individual lease and lease renewal this 11-page document, which spells out a whole bunch of stuff about the rents, the apartments, the instructions. We have at least 7 or 8 pages of instructions, which DHCR never sends us. We have to send it to the tenants. When we ask for things like this, they say, go online, it's all there. So we have to send this. When we send leases out, every month to some of our tenants, and this filling this thing out costs, spends time, takes a lot of time, and costs money. And it doesn't stop there. There's another one here when the apartment become deregulated. That's another 3 or 4 page document. And then if you have Section 8 tenants, there's a contract with Section 8, which goes on for, 12 pages. And then there's an addendum to that. So when all is said and done, the requirements of government have increased from 1 kg, but a standard lease may have, about half an inch of paper, and the leases are comparable. The renewal leases are comparable. So that's one of the reasons why, for instance, I have someone in my office who pretty much spends all of her time on dealing with DHCR matters, leases, MCIs, and renewal leases, and it's incredible how much the cost has increased. And what I'm saying is that this should be reflected in the guidelines. 4.3% means basically these are salaries for people to actually do work. Going beyond that,
5 minutes is up. So
okay,
wrap it up.
And then recently the DHCR establish the TPU, the Tenant Protection Unit, also known as the Landlord Harassment Unit, that if they require questions, they require answers, and it takes days sometimes to respond to things in the form they want.
Okay, Ken.
Okay, so I would ask that you consider the 4.3% increase in our real cost, which you documented, you know, in setting the guidelines for the coming year. It's a dull subject, so if anybody has any questions, I'm willing to respond. Yes, sir.
What forms are you required to prepare and file in addition to what you told us about for DHCR?
In addition to that, of course, we have to fill out the annual registration. So each regulated tenant, we have to fill out a form for the regulated tenant, for each regulated tenant. We also have to fill out the operation and maintenance cost surveys, which, of course, are always different than the rest of our costs. So we have to, you know, massage the cost of that. I mean, that's just the way it is when you're dealing with a regulated industry like we are.
As I commented last year, this is also the first time I have heard, you know, somebody speak for 5 minutes about what a pain in the neck it is to fill out forms. I just am a little bit
it's just fun. Someone, you know, in my office today was saying, fun doing this. So it's like,
well,
it is the way it is. But the thing that makes it different than a normal business is the regulatory requirements, especially DHCR, and especially in the last 2 or 3 years. The things that have happened that's been laid on DHCR. And I would think that they would, when they're thinking about increasing regulations, they would think about the cost, not only to us, but they're going to be incorporated into the costs to the tenants, because they're real costs. Thank you. Yes.
Good evening.
Good evening.
After 30 years, do you expect that this is going to be a cakewalk?
A cakewalk? No. No. It hasn't been for 30 years. And I've grown a very thick skin over 30 years.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Carol Danziger.
I live in a small 18-unit building. My family owns in the Village of Amerenik. My father, who worked as a barber, purchased the building in 1970 in hopes of providing a better life for his family. Had he made the same decision just 5 years later, after ETPA was adopted, he may have made a much different choice. My three siblings and I inherited the building 6 years ago. Whereas most people would see the opportunity on real estate as a financially beneficial one, most owners in this room know the truth can be far from that. I've attended the hearings for the past 2 years, and issues we face from ETPA definitely divides us into two obvious groups, owners and tenants. But in listening to the stories told here, I have found that each group has different sides as well. For example, there are many speakers every year on the tenant side of the issue with passionate and moving declarations to their experiences and difficulties in obtaining and keeping affordable housing in Westchester. And yes, it is a valid issue. But there are a group of tenants that you will likely never hear speak at these meetings. These are the tenants whose income by any given household subsidy standard, such as HUD or Section 8, should not be benefiting from ETPA rentals. Sometimes multi-generational, they have no business taking housing from those who desperately need it. Subsequently, you will hear arguments to the income befalling ETPA owners, how owners are making more and more profit every year. Now, I would have to make the assumption that there are owners out there that are actually making a profit with their properties, and they are one side of the owner group. And to me, they appear to be the side that is taken into consideration when deliberations happen. But please don't forget about the other owners, the ones like myself and my family. We have smaller, older buildings, and every year it gets harder and harder to just keep afloat. I wish I could actually make a living as a small business real estate owner, just as many of the tenants here wish they didn't have to struggle to pay for housing. The income from our buildings in some years is negative because of repairs. And in good years, I would say it's usually not enough to support a single household. I can't speak for all owners, but our core expenses, our heating, our insurance, and our taxes went up 9% over the past 2 years I've spoken here. And the increases to our rents went up approximately 1.5 to 4%. At this rate, it's only a matter of time before we sink. I was late getting here today because I work a full-time job outside of owning real estate, as does my husband, and we have on and off for the past 30 years we've been together. I have had a tenant representative shrug their shoulders at me and tell me to sell if things are so bad. I don't know how anyone could ever think that's acceptable. This building has been in my family for 45 years. Our father took pride in it, and it meant something to him, and it means something to us. Our tenants mean something to us, and we care about what happens to them. I live there. Okay, it's my home. Let's not fool ourselves. We're never going to have any real winners when it comes to UTPA. It's a nasty struggle over approximately 25,000 older units of rental housing in Westchester. And to our knowledge, New York State has never actually bothered to check to see if the tenants in these new units would qualify for subsidized housing. Because of this, right. In order to help the tenants that need it, you have to benefit the ones that don't. So please remember when you decide on an increase that the owner should have, there's another side and we can't be separated either. And we are trying to support our families, and we need your help too. Thank you.
Thank you.
CR has a program that assists owners and homeowners in repairs to their building.
What, the MCIs?
No.
Oh, okay.
Not MCI.
I'm sorry?
I will get to that.
Okay. I mean, we are doing repairs. We just struggle with them. We don't have a superintendent. My brother actually does all the work.
Mr. Lester?
I mean, there is a part of HCR, which includes HFA, the Housing Finance Agency, that does refinance property, finances new property. So I'll give you my card and we can talk about specifics to see if there's anything.
I'm sorry, I'm not sure. I'm just sorry to say.
I mean, there are programs that the state of New York offers for both purchase, acquisition, renovation of property. I don't know if you fit in the.
We want to lend you money.
The criteria, okay. But that is what the reverend is concerned
about.
I think she
has a
hardship.
One at a time, please, Mr. Cherson.
Chuck, are you familiar with hardship increases, I assume, right?
Yes.
There's a program for hardship increases. It's in the law, correct? When was the last time you saw one, granted?
1942.
Right. Then they are few and far between the set, at least, right?
Anybody else? Thank you very much. Gene DeResta.
reads to the Westchester Rent Guideline Board members, tenants, and landlords. I speak to you as a small business owner who earns the majority of his annual income from the rental of a 22-family residential apartment building at Warburton Avenue in Yonkers that is under EPA control, and a smaller three-unit building at Central Park Avenue, also in Yonkers, that is not. What is clear from statements presented to the board from both tenants and landlords is the adversarial relationship only gets more antagonistic each year. What I want to focus on during my brief statement is to document some new problems that have exacerbated the tenant-landlord relationship and made the management of rent-stabilized buildings even more difficult. Specifically, one, some programs, that should have been parentheses, so let's add, do not pay the approved rent guideline rent increases and make this point known to landlords upon lease renewals and not when the lease is being negotiated. Program two, programs do not supervise their clients' behavior during the tenancy. This has led to multiple lease violations, including damage to the apartments and allowing the client to bring in unauthorized guests. When a lease ends or is terminated by the program, the guests are now increasingly becoming squatters that can only be evicted by legal proceedings, whose expense is borne by the landlord. Three, incidence of bed bug infestations has increased and is due to tenants bringing in used and unchecked furniture. This leads to expensive extermination procedures borne by the landlord. Four, some tenants have started short-term leasing out of their apartment or a room within the apartment via strategies such as are espoused by Airbnb.com, where the tenant serves as hosts to paying guests. This violates their lease, no sublease clause, increases utility costs borne by the landlord, and creates potential liability problems for the landlords. Five, prospective tenants lie on their applications regarding who will be residing in the apartment and don't advise their program representatives about their intentions. This leads to increased utility expenses and frequently damage to the apartment, again resulting in expenses borne by the landlords. Six, tenants frequently don't pay their portion of the rent that results in legal collection actions. These, in turn, are nightmarish for the landlord because of the court's allowance of multiple order to show cause that result in significant rent loss and increased legal expenses borne by the landlord. These problems have all happened to me over the past year on multiple occasions and have resulted in significant lost revenue and damages to the apartment and increased legal expenses that the programs have insisted is not their problem. Their response is simply that glib colloquialism, it's the price of doing business. However, unlike other businesses that pass on their losses to customers, a landlord is prevented from doing so and must endure the loss. This is leading to landlords denying tenancy to prospective tenants on the basis of their sponsoring agency. And disgust is driving small landlords out of business. Rent increases are sought by landlords or necessary to cover expenses and losses as any other business. I can stop there because you have the statement.
Yes, we do. Thank you.
This is the article that I referenced. This problem is occurring in New York City right now in public housing. This article is May 15th.
What?
Mayor de Blasio, public housing seats.
Did you want to submit that to the board?
He submitted one copy.
I submitted one copy.
So we'll get it via email. The board members will get it. And I know you're comparing NYCHA, in effect, to rent-regulated apartments, which are separate and not, in my view, necessarily comparable, but we will definitely read your article, which actually I recall having read. Board members?
May I ask your address of your Warburton Avenue property?
411.
Anybody else? Thank you.
Yeah, you can have my copy.
Perfect.
Is it Tristan?
Good evening. 1956 was approximately when my apartment building was built. And my apartment represents that time frame. I am not making any massive complaints because I put up with a lot, and it's not a big deal to me that my cabinets and the rest of my appliances have pretty much remained the same since I moved in 1979. But the point is, I've been requesting a paint job for 22 years through possibly three management companies, and I have not had that addressed, nor have I made a big deal about it. But we recently got a brand new management agent who is extremely unavailable to the tenants, who is present here tonight. And they've taken, when I call the office, there's no one who ever answers the phone. I've left messages, I've left emails, and nobody gets back to me. But unfortunately, that's a minor issue. If one was to assess what it would cost to paint my apartment, as I understand it should be done approximately every 3 years, and that became a subsidy back to me, I'd be in great shape. As it is, since I've been renting, I've paid an increase every time my lease was renewed. So I don't understand why there's a big problem about getting another additional subsidy. I am rent stabilized. I live in an apartment building, I should say a condo or a residential hotel. The owner is rather confused and has tried to bring in many different aspects in order to raise her rental income. We have condo units, we have rental units, and we are now having Sarah Lawrence students pay the highest rent possible, and they live a very different lifestyle than residents who enjoy the original intent of the lease when it says quiet enjoyment. We're constantly dealing with pot, which is smoked on almost every floor by these students. They're not asked to ever put carpeting down in our leases. It said 80% of the apartment needed to be carpeted. But the floors are now done so beautifully that that's a selling point for the $1,800, I believe, they're asking for the new somewhat renovated apartments, which means they have new baseboards. And my apartment pretty much looks the same as it did when I moved in. So my only issue is I don't know why we are having a problem with this new rent request, especially when we've had all the landlords get some type of annual or every 2 years increase as long as I have been a tenant in this building for 36 years.
So just to be clear, you are a tenant in a rent-regulated apartment under
CPA. There's a few left in my building.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure I understood.
Yeah, there's a few left. When I asked the new managing agent if I could get a paint job, he came in and took a look and he said, well, we can do it for you, but you'll have to move all your furniture on your own. I don't know if this is something new. No, it's something I've never experienced this, so it means I have to hire someone to do furniture for me. But they still don't want paint for me. So I have lead exposed from the original paint that is chipped away on the baseboards, radiators, from when this building was built in 1956.
Ms. Roach, Eleanor, how many units in your building?
I believe it's something about, I'm not sure exactly, but it might be about 80.
And do you know how many are ETPA units?
There are not many left. Some of the older tenants are still there. Maybe there's a minimum between 15 and 20.
Where is your building?
It's Bronxville, PO, it's Yonkers.
Ellie? Anybody else? Thank you very much.
You mentioned that you've been there since 1979, and you do know that it is a city ordinance that you can get your apartment painted every 3 years.
I guess.
No, thank you. You're a part of Yonkers, am I correct?
Essentially, yes.
Yes. Thank you so much.
How big is your apartment?
It's 3 rooms.
1 bedroom?
1 bedroom.
Anybody else? Thank you.
Thank you.
Please spell the rest. Please spell the rest. Valerie Mazars.
Mazars.
Maz? I'm sorry, tell us your name again. I can't.
Valerie Mazars.
Mazars, that's Polish. Thank you.
I'm speaking as a member of the public. I am someone who has owned property in the county of Westchester. I sold my property in the county of Westchester. I choose to rent at this time. About 15 months ago, I went to corporate America and hung my own shingle and have a business where I go into residences and other environments and eradicate issues related to mold and odors and allergens. So I'm in and out of a lot of properties. And I have to say, I was a little chilled earlier today with some of the questions coming from members of the board inquiring with property owners as to how much profit they felt was fair or reasonable. That kind of line of questioning, honestly, I felt very socialistic, to be very honest with you. And if that were the case, we could, you know, live in the Eastern Bloc where everybody had exactly the same. People who own businesses, when I take in a payment from a client, the first 30% of what I take in goes into an escrow account to cover my tax responsibility. I don't even get to think twice about it. 30% goes. And then and that doesn't include anything related to all my risk and responsibility and costs and expenses to running the business. And because of the rules and regulations imposed on employers, I try to keep it as small as I can, because every person I add is additional responsibility and obligation that I have. People who own property have enormous risk that they are exposed to day in and day out. And the gentleman with the piles of papers, it's astonishing. And people are shying away from it. The people who own property, they do it as a way to make a living, and they care about the tenants who live there. Those who are slumlords, a pox on their house, and they will live in a very hot and dark place for all of eternity.
Yes.
Hold their feet to the fire, hold them accountable. They do have a heart to provide decent housing to people. And for those who, you know, do have the need for the rent stable and rent control, I get that. I serve on a board of directors for adults with mental illness. Our biggest issue is housing, even for those who can be employed. I have a sibling who has a severe case of mental illness. I get that need. I just ask that, please, be careful about having a bias. And when you go into these deliberations, do it fair, do it reasonably, taking all the information into account, that we can do what's fair and reasonable for all parties involved. Thank you.
Thank you. Albert Annunziata.
Yes, good evening, Madam Chairman and members of the Rent Guidelines Board. My name is Albert Annunziata. I'm Executive Director of the Apartment Owners Advisory Council of the Building and Realty Institute. I spoke in Mount Vernon, as you know, and I was particularly moved by this young lady's account of her problems in that large building in Mount Vernon, which she went into a bit more detail in Mount Vernon as to the horrendous conditions. And I denounced those conditions, and if you remember, I denounced the company and certainly urged the highest civic response, professional response against that building. However, it was interesting that she gave a little bit more information this time around, that she had discussed the issue with a number of people in the industry and real estate, whatever, And when I had left that meeting in Mount Vernon, several, I presume several of her colleagues came up to me and asked me for my card and were genuinely interested in what I had to say and maybe some help that I had to offer. But curiously, we didn't hook up at the end of that meeting. And if anyone did have a confab with all of those people from all facets of the real estate industry, then I'm a little puzzled how one could come to a zero guideline in any case, if you're getting, you know, a good sounding and a good input from all sides of the problem. The other lady from Bronxville, P.O. Yonkers, who said in her years since 79 that, that you know, the increases have been substantial. In 83 and 84, it was 0.0 and 0.3. In 94 and 95, it was 1.5 and 2.5. In 1998 and 99, it was 0 and 1.5. In 2010, 2011, it was 0 for one. When I use two numbers, it's the first percentage is for a one-year lease and the second percentage for a two-year lease. In 2010, it was 0.0. 2012, it was 1.25 and 2.25. So, you know, that's sprinkled along with other better years and other worse years. I think if anything, a lot of these stories underscore the fact there's a problem with maintenance. There's a problem with keeping up the properties, and this is exactly one of the major problems that we are trying to alert the citizenry, this good board, and the general public at large that a fair guideline commensurate with costs will certainly help to preserve the building, maintain the building, and a better maintained building is good for everyone. So I would just ask that you look at the facts and figures in a very broad-minded light, and in that spirit, in honor of the late Tempe Storm, I have some pens that will Mr. Lundy. It's a pen. One click is a light. It's a pen, and two click is a light. So you can distribute these.
One if by land, two if by sea.
One if by land, and two if by sea. And God rest her. Tempe Storm really set the. Set the stage for these little, to use an old Neapolitan phrase, these little tchotchkes I ask you to use the light of understanding, of perception. Obviously, if you come from the tenant side, or even as a public member, coming from a lifetime of tenant work, I don't ask you to renounce your lifetime of commitment to serving tenants. But, when you serve tenants, you have to understand where the landlord is coming from, because they're two parts of the same equation. And finally, the last speaker talked about, a fair and decent guideline for all and doing right by both tenants and landlords. I would think that would have gotten applause from everybody in the room. But somehow, when you talk about fairness and decency and just looking at a fair guideline, I noticed that the owners are always quick to clap for a fair guideline because they're so desperate. Look how desperate they are here. But the tenants didn't clap for that. I noticed a lot of the tenants didn't, and I don't understand that. Maybe in my naivete coming as a parochial schoolboy growing up in Mount Vernon, I always thought that fairness and decency were things to be applauded. But what the hell am I now? So anyway, use your lights. Use your flashlights to look at all the facts and figures, and appreciate their time as always.
Oh my God!
No, I think I've heard you call a lot of things, but never naive.
Well.
Anybody have any questions?
He is Diogenes.
What?
He is Diogenes.
Okay. Ms. Rubin.
Mr. Rosario is my father. Go on.
Thank you for coming and thank you for the same.
Sure.
We will certainly use it. And I wanted to ask you what the Reverend asked the other person who spoke. What would be in your mind a fair race?
That's a tough question. I mean, I haven't looked at all the facts and figures. And So I would have to defer to the good collective judgment of this body. I wouldn't even presume to come up with a figure. You know, I run the association. I listen to my good members here at Kvetch and complain all the time. I have no idea what they talk about. But seriously, I think, you know, the comparable answer that I think one of the young ladies on the tennis side said is that I would have to defer to your good judgment and weighing in all the facts and figures. I mean, something as simple as water that we take advantage of. Water rates, depending on the city, I think in Yonkers, they've absolutely skyrocketed. And I don't know if that point was brought up, but you know, it comes at you, the costs and the stats come at you from so many different angles. The system, look, as a matter of fact, nobody really knows that much about the tenants. The tenants could be rich or poor. It's a system that favors either one. But the landlord really has to pony up everything, has to pony up stats and income and expenses and open up your books and everything. And that's the regulatory system that we have to deal with. So the cards are pretty much on the table as far as the industry is concerned. But on the other side, I don't know, and I wouldn't know what a fair guideline would be. I do like the idea, you know, in principle of, at least there was an acknowledgement from the lady from Mount Vernon that, you know, maybe all landlords shouldn't be damned, but only the big guys. Even so, it was at least an acknowledgement that the problem is very complex and multifaceted, and I wouldn't, at this point, wouldn't know what number to throw out at you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Larry Johnston.
Good evening, members of the board, to the owners and to the tenants. My name is Larry Johnston. I'm a member of, I'm a resident at 30 Park Avenue in Mount Vernon, New York. And I am once again here to ask that the board recognize my request for a 0% increase. Now, I've heard a lot of testimony tonight coming from both parties, but on the owner's side, I hear generally they were given the numbers in 10 years, 20 years, and but this is a year to year, I believe a 1 year, 2 year, that every time we have I noticed that everybody's talking about the bills, and I see a lot of signs out there, the water, and but it's hard on us too. As a matter of fact, I hear everybody's talking about regulations, but we have to turn over a lot of documents just to see if we qualify to get into our apartments. Nobody's mentioning that. However, that is, I want to say politics, but I understand that's the way it goes. However, the real deal is 1.5%. That's how much of a COLA increase that I got. 1.5% this year. 1.5% last year. I believe it was zero the year before. So, I mean, I understand the owners and where they're coming from, but we are tenants. And
it is a complex problem, but we are hurting. And we are asking, we are begging for a break. Please, thank you.
Questions for Mr. Johnston?
Thank you, Mr. Johnston. Could you kindly tell us what employment you had?
Oh, I am a retired police officer from the city of Mount Vernon. I was retired on a gunshot wound to the brain. The bullet's still in my brain. So the city kept me for as long as they, until I said, I retired on my own terms, thank God. The city was real great. The community is real great, and that is why I, in turn, am not only speaking for myself, but I'm also speaking for the tenants and for the city, because they have been good to me, and I really appreciate it. And I, in turn, believe that not only is it my responsibility, but it's a general responsibility also to speak for them where they might not be able to speak for themselves.
Thank you for your service.
Yes, thank you for your service.
Reverend Walter?
Yes. I admire you. Thank you so much. Thank you for your courage.
Thank you.
You said when you were about to leave, you've been in the building for 7 years. And if I'm getting personal, please tell me, are you at 30% or 50% of your income in rent?
Oh, I am not quite. I believe I'm at a little bit more than 30%. I'm a little bit more than 30%. But not quite 50%. Mm-hmm. But like I said, it's not just me. It's other people too that are feeling.
Joel, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have two speakers left, but I just want to make sure that everybody who wants to speak has signed up. If there's anybody who wants to speak who hasn't signed the sheet, you can do so right now. I'll bring it to you. Okay, nobody else. In that case, Carmen Milio. I'm sorry, Carmelo.
Carmelo.
I'm sorry.
First of all, I just want to thank the gentleman for his services and his testimony. It's important, as a landlord representative, I feel that it is important to hear both sides of the story. And you know, a majority of what I want to speak to you guys about tonight is the fact that the housing industry needs stability. We need to stabilize the market so that tenants have somewhere to live. So, good evening. My name is Carmelo Emilio, and I'm an owner and property manager of ETPA regulated apartments in Westchester and New York City. I'm also the chair of the Apartment Owners Advisory Council of Westchester in the Mid-Hudson region. The AOAC represents approximately 300 owners of nearly 20,000 apartments regulated by ETPA. As the principal spokesman for Westchester landlords, I cannot emphasize enough how important your decision is for both landlords and tenants throughout the county. As a kid, I remember going around to a few small properties that my family owned, and I helped with cleaning, painting, and miscellaneous duties. During those days, it was a dream come true to own real estate with my family. 20 years later, the mentality has changed for many landlords throughout Westchester County. The reality is that this once sought-after American dream is now becoming a nightmare, especially for smaller landlords. Many landlords have been forced to sell or walk away from their buildings. In many cases, buildings were bought with life savings. In other cases, buildings were handed down as part of a multi-generational ownership, which many had a commitment to affordable housing. If you drive down many of the streets in our biggest cities, you will see boarded up buildings, many smaller buildings, mainly smaller buildings. I ask you to take a good look at the men and women sitting on both sides of the aisle. There is no exception. Tenant or landlord, or even the general public that doesn't get affected by a deteriorating building or neighborhood. We are all affected when a building is boarded up, regardless if you're the resident, landlord, neighbor, or vendor who used to service the building. Think about the last time you drove down a street and saw a 100-unit building boarded up. Never. That doesn't happen. That's the reality. It's mainly affecting the smaller landlords. You have to keep that in mind. Your decision affects the little guys much more than the much larger corporate owners. Wouldn't it be great if all those boarded up properties were still available as affordable housing? There would be many more units available to those who needed them, but unfortunately there was a reason that landlords walked away and the tenants lost their home. As for the DHCR tables, over the past 5 years, the average rent increase allowed by the board was 1.65% for a one-year lease and 2.55% for a two-year lease. These guidelines have not been fair nor reasonable, often not even matching the annual CPI. Fair increases result in improved buildings, better neighborhoods, and an overall improvement to that wonderful factor we know as the quality of life. DHCR financial tables also reflect an average size ETPA building of 29 units. The board has to remember that your decision is mainly affecting smaller landlords. The majority of people that smoke here today are smaller landlords. Even the tenants have mentioned that smaller landlords are affected far greater than the larger landlords. Last year, I sat here and witnessed two women with tears in their eyes express their concerns for the buildings they own and live in, and how it's impossible to operate with such low increases. They are just two of the hundreds of responsible landlords who strive and struggle to diligently maintain their investment, and of course, the supply of affordable housing provided by that investment. These people are currently being squeezed due to low increases. That's the reality, and that's the bottom line. Landlords supply the only major amount of affordable housing in Westchester County. You squeeze the landlords out, there will be no affordable housing. That is the reality. The people sitting in this audience are the ones that are creating and maintaining the affordable housing. They are not fat cats or big shots, as has been unfairly characterized over the years. These people are dedicated to supplying affordable housing, and their blood, sweat, and tears have gone into investments that give housing to all in need. I believe that the perception of the board can change with honest, sincere dialogue without personal attacks and character assassinations. It should not be tenants against landlords and vice versa. It should not be a matter of which group should enjoy your favor. You have to think about the entire picture as an integrated and an interdependent system. That is, if your goal is to preserve affordable housing. That's the final goal, preserve affordable housing. What you have to understand is that we need stability in our industry. When things go well for landlords, that's their opportunity to improve their aging buildings. And please also remember, as mentioned earlier in the question, that landlords are allowed to make a profit. Penalizing landlords for making a modest profit is equal to you working for free for the company that you work for. No one should be penalized for working hard and being compensated for, no matter what industry you're in, and especially when those positive years help carry you during the negative ones. No one should be looked down on for being successful. The more stable our industry, the more stable affordable housing will be. tenancy will be more stable with fewer turnovers and vacancies, since tenants will be confident that their buildings will not crumble before their eyes. To put the historically low rent increase into perspective, I want to put this in a way that I expressed last year, and you can all personally relate to. I want you all to take a second to think about your everyday job for a moment. Are you worth a 1.65% average annual raise over 5 years, which equates to $1.23 an hour raise on a $30,000 salary? How does it feel to do a good job, improve your company, only to get a 1.65% raise? Let me ask you, how long do you stay dedicated to your job and employer before you decide to lower your minimum daily productivity or bail out altogether? I'm sure that many landlords have had that cross their minds at one time or another.
Okay,
I generally appreciate the opportunity to address the board. I know some of you served as board members for some time now, and while others are new or relatively new, I ask you to draw upon your experience and see the interdependency, the multitude of factors that comprise the relationship between tenants, landlords, and the wider public. Thank you for taking my comments into consideration. I just really want to make it a point that it is for the industry. You need landlords, you need tenants, and together, affordable housing will live on. But if you continue to run in opposite direction, it's only going to affect that environment.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I didn't hear you in the beginning. You said that the AOAC represents 300 owners of approximately 300,000.
20,000.
I beg your pardon?
Nearly 20,000 apartments.
20,000 units?
Yes. 300 owners, 20,000 units.
That are, you're speaking just for membership in the AOAC?
No, I'm not. I'm speaking for the industry as a whole.
No,
speaking
no, my
for every
question
landlord
is,
that has their building
you're
in
saying the
Westchester County.
The question is, that you're saying that the membership is 300 owners in the AOAC?
No, I believe there's more. That's 300.
Just repeat what you said in the beginning, because I didn't hear what
I said. The AOAC represents approximately 300 owners of nearly 20,000 apartments.
Of 20,000 apartments?
Correct.
Okay. And you mean units?
Correct.
Okay. But you're aware of the fact that there are over 300,000 rental units in Westchester.
Yeah, that's why I said I speak to you as for the industry. I'm not speaking just for that amount of units.
Okay.
You know, I speak for landlords, but I think a lot of what I said are valid points for tenants as well.
Okay, and I thank you for your statement saying that landlords should be allowed to make a modification.
They should be. They should. I mean, if the reality is, if you go to work and you don't make a dollar, you're not going to work anymore, and that's equivalent to any job that anybody has. That's the reality.
I think there are a great many people in their stabilized departments who would love a 1.65 increase over 5 years, which would be.
You need a certain amount of an increase to maintain a property. Properties age over time. You know, it's an industry that needs an increase on an annual basis to maintain the buildings. I mean, that's just the reality. You guys see that from the tables in your ear.
Did you
have
a comment?
Yeah, I had a comment. I think my understanding is there's approximately 25,000 ETPA-controlled units in Westchester County. I don't know what the 300,000 has to do with anything, but am I right in approximately that number, Chuck?
Correct.
25,000. Thank you.
Thank you. Dennis Hanbury. And you need a little more time.
Yeah. These are from this aquifer, most of them, they said, I can't discriminate, so everybody has that. And most of the board members have seen that previously. Madam Chairperson, board members, audience members, my name is Dennis Hanbury. I'm the Executive Director of Vernon United Tenants. And I'm going to confine my remarks pretty much to vacancy issues. Now, we've heard a lot, and I responded, I talked in Mount Vernon hearing about when Rachel Estroff, chief of staff of somebody, when Shelley Mayer was asked about by one of the landlord reps about what, for the zero, what about this cost increase? Well, I'm going to talk about some increases that the landlord's going to get regardless of what you do. Outside of that, just in your own schedules on the vacancies, it shows the average increase for 1 year leases, rents went up $217. It was 1,274 units that went there. That's a total increase on a month of $276,458. For two bedrooms, the mean rent went up $236 for 418 units, bringing a dollar figure of $98,648. The total was $375,106 increase. Now that's representing approximately 60% of the schedules. So if we do our math, that brings the increase that the landlords got last year, outside of guideline increases, to $625,000 a month. And if we do that times 12 per year, we're talking about a $7.5 million increase. $7.5 million increase if you gave a zero increase. $7.5 million increase. The numbers are right there. And I also ask you to look very carefully. Could you please be quiet? I didn't interrupt you.
I am not talking.
Sir.
Well, who's ever talking?
Don't look at me.
Who am Dennis?
I'd rather not, believe
Dennis,
me.
Dennis,
yeah, I share your sentiments.
And you, sir, please.
I'd ask.
He attacked me in case
nobody
you weren't paying attention.
Anybody.
Yeah.
Let's proceed.
I asked the board to carefully review the vacancy schedules, okay? If you look at every cohort, there's eight cohorts from zero to 399, from 400 to 599, 600, and so on, up to 1600 net. Every one of these schedules, the biggest number is in the 1600 and up. The damage has already been done. When I hear these things about the increase, they're getting the money. All the rents are up in the $1,600 category. They're all virtually one vacancy away from being decontrolled. I mean, how much more? They're getting $7.5 million without you guys giving anything. 0% guideline, they still get $7.5 million increase. That'll cover their expenses, their increased expenses. Look at the numbers, okay? Our representatives are going to make a very detailed presentation next week, okay? But as I normally do, I focus on the vacancies because very few people look at that. That's where the big money is. That's where the big money always has been for the real estate. They know that. They play that. They, you know, may nibble around corners, but the real thing is the vacancies. That's where the bread is buttered. So I ask you to look at those schedules very carefully. Look at the numbers. We'll give you more of a detailed analysis of that. Thank you.
Thank you. Board members? Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, I'm angry. I was attacked.
Sir, please.
I tried to apologize to him.
Yeah, it's disingenuous.
You can apologize outside later, or whatever you want. That concludes our speakers. Before we adjourn, I just want to announce the final two meetings, which I've done at all of the public hearings. Tuesday, June 16th at 7 o'clock. Very hard to keep some of this stuff straight. It's in the White Plains Library Auditorium. White Plains Library Auditorium, 100 Martine Avenue. The purpose is to, for the owner and tenant members and the board to make their presentations. They're going to be, they'll divide up their 20 minutes of allotted time any way they wish. And I hope that you will be able to join us for that meeting. Tuesday, June 16th, White Plains Library.
Monday, June 22nd is our final public meeting of this year. The owner and tenant board members will have a chance to rebut each other's statements of the previous meeting. They won't have as much time as they did in their presentations. And then we will set about setting the guidelines, and we will hopefully emerge with a guideline that probably everybody will hate, but that will mean that it's fair. I hope everybody doesn't hate it. Well, thank you all very, very much for coming in tonight, and hope to see you on the 16th and the 22nd. The 22nd meeting, by the way, is in White Plains, City Hall, right here.
I have a motion to adjourn.